Talk about how they use Python in their gava.de infrastructure.
Yeah, hi, good morning. I have a small agenda. This is normally a 1.5 hour talk, and so I will talk very fast and try to skip over some slides to show you what we do with Python at Rewe Digital and how we have one special use case, which is called intrusion detection. If somebody thinks it is about hacking, I guess he's perhaps in the wrong talk, then it is more about bots and scrapers which frequent our sites. So I try always to have first a broad overview over the topic and what we do exactly, and at the end of each of these five or six topics there is an how we did it and what we learned element in it. So hopefully a lot of people can take stuff with them. So about me, first of all, who is this guy? I'm normally a developer at Rewe Digital, and now because I'm in a big data team and at a data scientist team, I can call myself a data scientist, and I'm there since 2015. But first of all, because I think there are a lot of international people here, I have basically two questions in this talk. The one will be at the end and one will be now. Do you actually know what Rewe Digital does, or has anybody a clue about it? Can just a raise of hands or so? Two, three, five? Okay, that's not much. Okay, so in three sentences, Rewe Digital is a daughter company of a grocery store chain here in Germany and in Austria for parts. And the Rewe Digital basically creates a product where people can go on a shop site and buy food and groceries, and we will deliver it to them. So we don't use something like DHL or something like that. These are our cars and our people who bring the stuff to you. And we have the full sortiment, which means that you can buy everything from easy sellable goods like noodles or frozen pizzas to goods that get bad very fast if you don't handle them well, like minced meat, for example. So, okay, but the main thing we have is, of course, the app and the web page. We have a lot of visitors on our page. It's called shop.rewe.de. Normally we have a lot of visitors on our page, and these are, for example, humans who, in the best case, want to get fresh groceries and want to get them delivered to their home, or people who try to get information about their food, so if they are allergic to stuff or things like that, or look out for a special act. Price offerings where they see, my favorite coffee is currently at a sale. So, furthermore, we have some stuff like recipes. Apart from humans, there are, of course, machines. These machines try to index our pages, for example, for search engines, which is super great, because if someone enters cucumber in a search query at Google or Bing, it would be great that we would be found and that we would be at the first place, of course. And so we shouldn't disallow them to go onto the page. Furthermore, and then it gets a bit trickier, there are machines who basically crawl our web pages to get our prices. So if they have, for example, a price comparison page. This is, I think, still okay, so it's not a bad case, because if someone is very interested or very interested in the prices, he always wants to see the cheapest products, and so perhaps this will drive customers. But then if we are at the end of the spectrum, there are machines who look for potential attack vectors. Yeah? They basically scrape our page and, for example, see that some parts of our search takes unbelievably long, or if they add stuff to the cart, something bad happens. And this is bad because, I guess, and you have heard it in a lot of companies, there are always like people who try to DDoS your page and do bad stuff with you. So try to get money out of you. These machines create costs. For example, the log data and disclaimer: we never store any data personalized. Yeah, we can never identify the person behind that. Everything is anonymized, but we store it in an anonymous way, and this creates basically large log data. And then we are at one place in the area of big data, of course. Then at peak times, if there are a lot of bots, our customer experience is bad. And last of all, if, for example, the page for a certain type of frozen pizza is queried a lot, someone could get the idea of, oh, there is a high demand on this product, so please buy more of this. So the first idea we had, or the first idea we implemented, was a simple rule-based system. Rule-based systems are basically okay, but the bad thing about this, they have to be created by humans who look at the past. They look where are the requests are coming from, or in which speed are they coming from, and so on. And they create some rules out of it. And there is this problem that humans don't always see the connections and causalities, especially if they look at back in the past. There could have been a TV commercial which ran at the time, or so the problem is all these values basically change often, and it is hard for a human to actually create and modify the rules all the time. So, of course, a machine learning approach has to be done. So, first of all, to give you a big overview on how everything is matched in this area. So, it's always hard to explain this slide, right? On the right, of course, we use, for example, TensorFlow. We don't use it directly. We use Keras as a library to talk to TensorFlow to make it easier for developers and data scientists to create rules and models and all that. We have certain people at our company who are data scientists and don't do any programming or don't want to do any programming, and we offer them stuff like Jupyter netbooks, notebooks, and even R servers. But of course, R is, I guess, not very welcome here. So on the left side, we have a lot of data transport stuff. I guess you know all the logos there from Google, so we run everything on Google. And to get the data from our microservice architecture, we use Kafka, which I guess which is a message bus with a lot of properties like retention, and it's very fast, and it's quite cool. First of all, if we take, for example, one log entry, and this log entry is, it looks a bit like an access log, right? You see some stuff which would put out any, Apache server, but there is more stuff in it, which is not actually visible, because this is like none and zeros and only numbers. But I will explain it very shortly. And in the end, we try to get some vector out of it. And then we train our networks, and at the end we get an output vector and can say, oh, this request is coming from a bot. And in this example, it would be a good bot because it was a Bing bot. So, the first part on our agenda is feature engineering. So, feature engineering, as we found out, is one really, really time-consuming part of in the whole chain to our solution, because there are a lot of people involved, and you create some features and then you want to try them, and there is not many ways to see if the if the features which people designed or try to get out of the data are actually working or helping to you to predict stuff. So what are features? I basically wrote it down. It's like Wikipedia, right? But on the end, features are used to make variables out of it, yeah, which are in our case numbers from 0 to 1. There are neural networks, of course, now where you can just put plain text into it and they do everything for you. But we try to keep it simple and create real numbers out of it. And the features, I guess the most important thing is that they have to be distinguishable. So what this means, there shouldn't be one feature which is called is action item or is reused item, and then there is another feature which could perhaps be the price, because if you take a look at both features, they would be they would be dependent, right? And this is not a very good feature. So how do we do feature engineering? Of course, I guess like everybody here, we try to basically Google for it. Yeah, there are a lot of papers and books out there which we try to read, and our data scientists and me, we are always looking out for new solutions from other companies or at other talks. Then we have, because we're using Google BigQuery, it is possible to take a look at our data. You know, we can basically create queries and look at the results and see, this is working, and this looks like a good feature. So furthermore, we try to apply automatic feature engineering. So this is quite interesting, because you basically don't design your features yourself, but there are algorithms and tools out there who can basically take your data and create features for you. And at the end, of course, test and check everything. So we not only have the access log, which is here at the top of our data sources example blob. every visitor basically does a lot of things on our page. So because we use a microservice architecture, a lot of stuff is logged. Yeah. This could be very obvious things like time, or more interesting things like a header order you get from a browser or the ratio in which you browse through our pages. An example for this would be a bot or a crawler would be very interested in all the detailed pages, right? Because they want perhaps create their own food network page, and they need all the data they can get, like nutrition facts and allergy related stuff and all that. So if we see that someone is always going to the detail pages, it looks not suspicious, but it is an indicator. Normally a normal person would always use category pages and use the smaller ways to get to get stuff in his basket. All this experimenting with all the data, of course, takes time, and we try to automatically do everything. Yeah? We try to fetch the data and do all this automatically until to the deployment and actually to the running. So we use Kubernetes, which is a tool from Google, which has very good autoscaling functionality. So, for example, our predictors, which using TensorFlow, and we have different implementations on how our microservice has this REST interface to give answers to predictions, to requests which are coming in. We even have some version which uses Scenic, but it works really good. It didn't crash, and I don't know. Have you ever used Scenic? It's more of a fun project using UV loop. No, it's a Python. Look it up. It's quite cool. But we try to do this everything automatically. So even benchmarking the results. So we have test sets and try to store that. So in a perfect ideal solution, I would create for a really cool data scientist who doesn't want to program an environment where he just can use his data analytics tool of his choice and only has to create some classes from it. And how do we do this? I hope this is a bit readable. We created something which we called feature classes. I know there are other implementations for basically the same thing out there, but we did it on our own. They are defined in JSON, and they can be read by all the microservices which basically need to know about features like the predictor and the quantifier and all that. And I will show you some examples for feature classes which we basically created and data scientists can use. So one is called, for example, very easy one, group. Yeah, we call this feature type group, but it is nothing more than a one-hot encoding. A one-hot encoding works basically in this example or like this. We have basically the number of in our array, a number of elements which can be set to one if we look at all the different, in this example, brands. So, for example, when we decide that BMW is the number one in our array, then we always set the first, the second element to one and all others to zero. So, one-hot encoding. One-hot encoding is quite interesting, but always a bit tricky because if you have a lot of different brands, like in this example, you get arrays which have a lot of zeros in them. And when I show you the models, it will be bad because you get very sparse vectors, and the predictions or the results on these are not always great. So basically, for this example, we would create a feature class like that. The one at the beginning means that it should be counted as the first one, and you can give it a name, and you can tell that this is a feature type group, and it's not required, and has no default value. Another one, which I guess everybody uses here, is a multi-column percentage. For this example, we have a table with rainfall in Germany, based on five cities, and we basically can calculate a percentage of that and basically create a vector for it, which represents the percentage of each value in this row. This basically looks like this. As you can see, there is always a bit stuff like column names, because at the end there is one data store where we store data. This does not have to be an actual database with columns. It could be a NoSQL database, but in this case, basically all the time, use Google BigQuery, so we work with columns, right? So a last example, for example, if we try to work with IP addresses, I guess these are all private ones, to not make too much trouble, a data scientist could think about how to create from IP addresses a vector for data for it. He can use his regular expressions for those, and the idea could perhaps be that an IP which starts in the same with the same most important number is basically perhaps physically located to a different IP, or is belonging to the same company like Hetzner or Telekom, or and if you see some bots working on these servers, you could imagine perhaps assume stuff from it. This is a bit more complicated. There's a lot of ugly escaping, but again, this will be put into our microservices. The good thing about this is we implemented a lot of feature classes, and every time a data scientist comes to one of the platform people, and we can discuss and create more of those. Yeah. So I gave you three examples, but there are more, like a very obvious one, like direct. If there is a number which is already already working very well, we can basically copy it. And yeah, in the future there can be many more, and they are extendable via Python modules, as you can imagine. So our takeaway there is, if you work with data scientists who don't want to program that much, try to help them. They use JSON, and they like that stuff. So the next part would be model design. Model design, in the end, what can be said about it? The first thing is, don't try to be too complicated. So when we started creating the first models, we thought about multiple hidden layers, like 10 or 20, because Google does it, right? But in the end, it looks like this. Try to get a basic, very simple model working, right? And then you can go into the deep learning aspect and try to add more and more hidden layers. So it is again a race, right? Because the bigger models, they take a long time to train, and that is bad, because we need we want to see results very fast. Furthermore, when you create the model, you can think about how your actual use case works. Or in other words, what I want to say is, for example, do you want to take a clustering approach, or do you want to take do you want to work supervised or unsupervised, right? So the features itself, they don't care about that, but when you create your model, it is done. And again, I guess this is true for all the topics. Try to do your own research and read some papers. Some examples about supervised and unsupervised learning, but I guess you know about supervised and unsupervised learning, right? Between, for example, classifiers or cluster finding. So, the good thing, perhaps, about unsupervised, because not everybody does it all the time, is that we often found interesting things which no data scientist or no one came found out by himself or herself. So he basically looked into it, and we used some clustering methods on that, and saw, there is some data visible which was not visible, or nobody thought about it first. So more examples about for classification. But classification, okay, always the problem, it has very long training spans, right? You have to create your test data at first and your training data at first, and have to see and have to classify everything to train the model, which can be quite daunting, and nobody wants really to do it, but you have to do it. Otherwise, if you use some simple rule set, like if the origin IP is in China, for example, then you more or less create a model which basically predicts if the IP is starting with a certain number or not, but it never classifies anything better than that. Examples for unsupervised models. The clustering approach. The cool thing about this is, if you visualize your data and visualize your result, you see dependencies on your data which you didn't see before. This is super interesting. I guess k-means is some method which you could use for that. The next thing is, deep learning, everybody talks about it, and of course, to get this room, I try to put deep learning into the title, and of course it works, to get from a shallow network, so a non-deep network with only one hidden layer, to a deep network is not more or less than some lines of code, and then having to run your stuff longer. But when you go this way, yeah, you always, or we always try to approach it from a simple solution, right? Because if the simple network doesn't work, yeah, we never it never goes to the stage of to a deeper network. Then, of course, try to create so many features as possible. Because why? yeah, it, we found out that this works basically quite great. Clock wouldn't be bad, but okay. So of course, what technologies again? What do we use? We use Python a lot. Yeah, as we said, all these microservices, the predictor, the quantifier, the training service are all written in Python. Yeah, they offer REST services. We use even Flask for it, even sometimes Scenic and other libraries. But if you don't want to use Python, of course, I have to say it, because we put it in a container, we put it in a pod, which is a Google thing for container deployment. We can basically put everything into some sort of element, and then we can support it. We have a lot of success with Keras, which has great Python support. And it is better to, in our opinion, to work with Keras, because a lot of the tedious talk you need to do when you work with TensorFlow directly, like creating variables and all that, Keras takes care of that. And you can far easier create models in Keras. And in the end, if Google doesn't allow TensorFlow anymore, or something bad like this happens, Keras supports multiple backends. So if you want to use something from Microsoft or Theano, I guess you can basically switch this out. But recently, Theano was pronounced dead, I've read. But on the local testing, we use CUDA, libcuda, and normally notebooks with a big graphic cards with a big graphic chip in there, and we use TensorFlow on that. And on the server side, we rent the servers from Google to use their machine learning platform, which basically is graphics cards at the end as well, right? Then we use, of course, TensorBoard. I have some screenshots in later slides. So what is currently our best model? Yeah, it's hard to say, because we haven't found the best setup yet. So because our life cycle works basically like this. We create a setup, we put some features into a features JSON file, destroy all our old instances and start them back up, and we do this every day. So if a data scientist basically has some great idea of a combination of features with a 10-layer deep neural network, it will live for about 24 hours, and it can work, and we can benchmark it. And if he wants to, it can live longer, for a longer time, but normally after 24 hours, the flow of the old training, the old trained network goes back into storage, and we get the new trained network back live. The reason for that is we found out that a lot of stuff is changing, especially a lot of people switch from IPv4 to IPv6. There are even more browsers coming out every day, and furthermore, our site changes fast as well, right? URLs are changing, which is, again, I guess, bad for SEO, but and therefore we have to have a constant change, of our structure we have to work, or we have to live with that our structure is basically changing like all the time. So, okay, our best setup. So if we look at a high score table with our best results, our best model so far had only four hidden layers, which still sounds as a deep neural network, right? It is a dense network. A dense network basically means that all the nodes are concatenated with, are connected to each other. So there are approaches for a fan-out and fan-in solutions, but yeah, this one was a dense one. And again, it used Keras and TensorFlow. How does the model look? Yeah, this is an old example. This is an old example from our this is an old example from our Git account. So this is not really good. The only interesting stuff here is, apart from the dense stuff, that there is a dropout of basically 50%, which basically means that random in a random way we throw away 50% of the weights on the things. Okay, but next thing, model training. Model training is basically very simple, right? Because we just started and everything should work. TensorFlow offers a cluster environment, but we haven't come so far to get it running into a cluster environment. And we need more web interfaces for the result of the training, because a lot of the stuff is basically output. I have a screenshot for that. Okay, so the next thing is how does the training actually work? Yeah, right, we get our raw data from a data lake. A data lake is something which basically has all our data in a Google BigQuery environment, right? And then we have quantify microservices, which quantify all the data, and this creates vectors between 1 and 0, and these data is taken to train the model in case it is a supervised approach, or we try to cluster or do other stuff of it, and we try to look at TensorBoard. First of all, when we call Keras, I don't know if you have ever worked it on this. It basically looks like this. You see the result of your loss function and how accurate this run is, and this epoch. An epoch is in Keras something which basically changes up the data for each run. So TensorBoard is a quite cool tool. You should use it. So because TensorFlow has the possibility to write its weights and all the data into a TensorBoard folder, and you can just simply start TensorBoard and look at your results. A lot of people use it for image detection and image classification, which is not really a lot of our use cases, but it works for just numbers as well. But if you don't know what you're doing, it could look, how can the accuracy function be more than one? It's strange to so, but it can work in a bad way. So prediction, which is, I guess, the last part is, I guess there's still time for questions then. If a user visits our platform, there's basically two views how to see him. First, we can see him as some sort of session, like he does continuous stuff on our page, adds stuff to his basket, and looks at product detail pages and searches for product, or we can see it as a simple access log. And for both have different models underlying, because we can make predictions about this from another way. As I said, the page ratio for a simple access log is not working, because a bad crawler could basically reset his page ratio all the time. But this would be, again, very suspicious, because we would only see that he would go directly to the detail pages like all the time, which no normal user can do. So what are our countermeasures? To basically block everybody from our page who we think is a bot or a bad person, it's not a good idea, because these, in case of false positives, this would be catastrophic. Perhaps a programmer couldn't buy his favorite stuff anymore because he's very good with his mouse, right? So banning is not good. Tar pitting is also not a good solution. because this only puts strain on our whole architecture, so we don't do that. Another way what we thought about is provide falsified information. Yeah, we could basically jack up the prices by 500% or basically do it sell very expensive champagne for cent money, but we don't do that because this is bad if this works well. So what is the only thing what we do is, yeah, the user has to solve a captcha, which is basically the same thing which every Google user who does too many Google queries has to do, or any Facebook user who has suspicious activity has to do, right? So furthermore, there is for harder instances, we have a security team. It's on the left side. It is HipChat. I don't know if anybody knows it. I guess all the cool people use Slack, but HipChat is from Atlassian. And we, in this example, these are all test servers because we test our own platform. So these are not, again, not real IPs. So the IPs are real, but we are behind them. And they are informed about, and for example, if there are a lot of requests from a certain area, we can go to network infrastructure guys and basically prevent DDoS attacks. So what will be in the future? And I guess the time is basically last 5 minutes. Okay, what is coming in the future? Okay, we try to do more generalization. Yeah, we try to implement a solution that data scientists can use, right? And we have always to think about that not everybody writes code. Yeah, there are perfectly good mathematicians out there or statistic guys who don't want to program in any language, and we have to help them create a new a solution which helps us without programming. So an ideal world would be some sort of UI interface where they can do stuff. Yeah, the other thing, performance is important. So 5 minutes for questions. Thank you. Sorry for this being so fast. Okay, first question. Sure.
Wait. Microphone for the.
So you very briefly mentioned automatic feature engineering and the, can you expand on that a little bit? Well, what tools, which algorithms are you using for that?
Basically, I can't expand so much on that. I know that we created it, that people use it, and. But I can't really remember what exactly we did there. I can't answer that. But if you want to, you can. I can write you an email about it. So okay, sorry. Okay. Yeah. Shoot. Oh, or you? Oh, sorry.
Thank you for the presentation. I think the use case is really interesting. But I have two short questions.
Sure.
The first question is: if you do supervised learning, how do you obtain your labels? Because the bots won't tell you that they're bots, right?
Yes.
If you're doing unsupervised learning, how do you evaluate your model or your prediction?
Perfect. So this I can answer. The labeling of the data is super complicated, and we have multiple approaches. Yeah, there is one way, for example, if we see that this is a real customer would be, or now real customer is perhaps a bad word. So if we see that at the end there was a buy event, yeah, someone bought actually that. If someone writes a bot which buys stuff on our page, I guess we are super fine with it, so we will never declassify him. So one is looking at the result. So our result, what we at the end want to have, is that he created an order at the end. The other thing is, in the past, when I am talking about denial of service attacks and ransom using denial of service, this is not just a hearsay. It actually happens on e-commerce sites, and you can always look back then in the logs and see which sessions or which activities in our logs resulted in actions which have the only result in getting our platform slower and getting a bad experience for the user. So it is again looking at the past, and then we can classify the data. So the question about unsupervised learning was what? How we? I forgot this again. Sorry again. Ah, of course, yeah. We have at the end. A sort of accuracy check. Yeah, again, real people, or not again, real people look at the results, and they see if our models, which we created, basically classified people or sessions as bad, and. Yeah, and basically it is, to give a short answer, basically humans do it. They look at the result and look if the result is good or bad. Not Saturdays and Sundays, and not like from Monday to Friday like each day, but as often as it is necessary, I guess would be a good answer. Yeah, we change it every day. This is often for our supervised approaches, right? So, and I can't tell all the KPIs we use, but one, for example, would be if there is a real order created or not. And these, of course, can be done automatically, but there's also a human part to it, and there are other values. In which we see that this is that this was a bad behavior. Basically yes. For example, you could imagine, yeah, we don't do it, but we could imagine that there is some sort of falsified data given out, like a very low price for stuff which is not what is not usual in the market, and you look at the other. At other places in the internet and see if these stuff pops up, or you put a product with ingredients which actually doesn't exist, and you see if this is used on places where, and you see you can create, for example, paths in your shop that which are not visible to the user, but result on product detail pages which. Yeah, no real user would see. So there are ways, and yeah. Oh, there? Oh, no? Yes?
Any other questions? We still have time for some questions. Yes.
Yeah, of course. I can repeat it if you want. Okay, yes? Okay, so the question was we don't want to have false positives. And you have seen that we, for example, in the model that I showed, we look at the accuracy. And yes, okay, so this was just one example for a lot of models we use. And I can't give you right now an example because I can't think about of right now. but we use other functions as well. So we try to limit the danger of false positives by just showing captures. Yeah? So for example, I guess you as a person now have been classified by Google as a capture has been shown to you, right? Or has it happened in the past? Yeah, okay. So I guess everybody had this experience at once. So of course this was then the false positive, and yeah, then this approach we did was perhaps not the best, right?
Let's thank Carsten for his presentation and